Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I welcome all of you to another virtual Friday khutbah. We are continuing our series on Dhul Hijjah, and now that Dhul Hijjah is only a day or maybe 2 days away, we will talk about some of the things that we can immediately act upon in preparation for the month of Dhul Hijjah, and especially the irreplaceable, the unique, the incredible 10 days that are upon us. So I hope you will stick around for this short and brief reminder. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. We begin as always by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by thanking him immensely for all of the blessings he has bestowed upon every single one of us, blessings that you and I are aware of and blessings that play a critical role in our everyday lives. And we are absolutely oblivious to them. We are absolutely clueless about them. But those blessings are so incredible. For those blessings that we are aware of and those who are not, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immensely for. And we bear witness and we testify that there is none that deserves our unconditional obedience, that deserves the right to be worshipped, to be called upon, to be prayed to, except for the one and only true creator of the heavens and the earth. And we bear witness and we testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his last and his final messenger, his slave and his perfect worshipper and a role model for all of humanity until the end of days. My dear listeners, the month of Dhul Hijjah may begin either on Saturday or on Sunday, which is July 10th or July 11th. And if you are from those people who feels that, you know, my Ramadan, I could have done more, I could have utilized it better, then you feel that there's that little bit of a vacuum, do not despair. The days of Dhul Hijjah are here, and in the last few episodes we talked about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made these first 10 days even greater than the days of Ramadan. So let us seize every single opportunity that we can get. Hadith reported in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad upon the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he heard the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that in these 10 days, increase in your takbir, your tahmid, your tahleel, and your tasbih. Now, what does all of this mean? Tasbih means saying subhanallah. Takbir means saying Allahu Akbar. Tahmid means saying Alhamdulillah. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, is reminding us, and of course, tahleel, the fourth thing that's mentioned in the hadith, means saying La ilaha illallah. Now, what is the significance of dhikr? My dear listeners, go and read four ayat that belong to Surah number 33, Surah Al-Ahzab. And the reason I always give references is so we can go and familiarize ourselves with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at what Allah azza wa jal is reminding you and me regarding the blessings and the immense rewards for reciting the words of remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah azza wa jal tells us in Surah 33, Surah Ahzab, verse number 41. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا وسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, O you who have believed, immediately you and I should be alert. We should pay further attention. Allah is talking amongst all of humanity. He is referring to only those people who've decided to surrender their wills and their desires to their maker, their creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To that group of people, Allah is saying, pay attention. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who claim to have belief, who have faith, who have iman. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, dhkurullaha dhikran kathira. That make sure you engage in the remembrance of Allah immensely, in abundance. Remember Allah a lot. Wasabbihuhu bukratan wa asila. And mention his tasbih, meaning subhanallah, in the morning and in the evening. What does the word subhanAllah mean? I'm sure most of us have learned this right from childhood, that after we finish our prayers, we should say subhanAllah 33 times. We should say alhamdulillah 33 times. We should say Allahu Akbar 33 times. And when the time of Eid comes around, we hear our elders who have taught us to say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, walillahi alhamd. Which combines, now this particular dhikr, words of remembrance, it combines all of these four things. The takbir, the tasbih, the tahmid, and the tahleel. Saying la ilaha illallah, saying subhanallah, saying alhamdulillah, saying Allahu Akbar. Right? Allah is saying, say these things. Let us quickly talk about the meanings of these four words of remembrance. Subhanallah means to say how exalted you are, O Allah, from all sorts of deficiencies, all sorts of literally garbage that people ascribe to you. Words such as God has forgotten, or that God rested, or that God is not all-powerful. A'udhu billah. These are not things that are befitting of an all-powerful, almighty creator, the one that we worship. No, so we say subhana. How far removed, how far above, how far exalted you are, O Allah, from all kinds of deficiencies that are ascribed to you. That's the meaning of subhanallah. Alhamdulillah means all perfect praises belong to you, O Allah. And I've mentioned this several times in my other classes where we talk about the tafsir of Surah Fatiha. Yes, the Surah Fatiha that you and I recite a minimum of 17 times every single day in our 5 daily prayers. Alhamdulillah, hamd means praise that is all-encompassing. Praise that comes from a heart that adores the being that he or she is praising. That is what hamd means. A type of praise that is all perfect, that no other praise can even come close to. That's the meaning of alhamdulillah. Allahu Akbar, O Allah. And common translations say, you are the greatest. But Allahu Akbar is actually the comparative. It's not the superlative, comparative. And it's so beautiful. A little bit of Arabic lesson over here. Allahu Akbar, Allah, you are the greater. Greater, really? Why not greatest? Well, greater meaning anything and everything that comes to my mind that is trying to compete with your remembrance, O Allah, in my prayer. Something is trying to distract me from the prayer. O Allah, you're greater than that. My meeting, I'm remembering my meeting. O Allah, you're greater than my meeting. My dollars, my investments, the stock or the crypto that I'm dealing. O Allah, you're greater than that. O Allah, you're greater than the ball that I need to go play with my buddies outside. O Allah, you're greater than the movie that's starting. O Allah, you're greater than the games that are... No, O Allah, you're greater than anything and everything. And hence, we find translations that say Allah is the greatest. Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. There is no being that is deserving of worship except for you, O Allah. No being, no stick, no stone, no saint, no prophet, no messenger, no human, no object, nothing is deserving of worship except for you, O Allah. La ilaha illallah. So I hope, inshallah ta'ala, you've understood the meanings of these four words of remembrance. Now let us come back to the point that I was mentioning. Surah Ahzab, Surah 33, verses 41, 42, 43, and 44. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who claim to have iman, claim to have faith, claim to have belief, remember Allah. Mention His tasbih, subhanallah, a great deal. وَسَبِّحُوا بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. Mention His words of remembrance a great deal and say subhanallah morning and evening. And what will happen? هُوَ الَّذِي يُصَلِّي عَلَيْكُمْ وَمَلَائِكَتُهُ لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues, هُوَ الَّذِي, He is the one who sends salah upon you. You're like, what? Salah? Doesn't salah mean prayer? So does God mean that He is praying to us and we've suddenly become demigods or mini-gods? A'udhu billah, no. When God Almighty sends salah upon us, it means He's conferring His favors upon us, His gifts upon us, His blessings upon us. هُوَ الَّذِي يُصَلِّي عَلَيْكُمْ. Just like we say, assalamu alaykum. Allah is speaking the second person directly to you and I. Allahu Akbar. What? Really? Why? Now Allah is telling you and me the results, the consequences, the end game of what dhikr is going to get you and me. It's going to get me Allah and the blessings of the malaika, the angels. And Allah says, يُخْرِجَكُمْ, He will, so that He can take you and me out from darknesses into light. Darknesses of what? Darknesses of sins. Darknesses of our deep and dark desires. Darknesses of disobedience. Darknesses of evil. Allah will take us out from this. And notice the accuracy, precision of the Quran. ظُلُمَات, it's not ظُلْم. ظُلُمَات, meaning darkness is plural. Into, Allah can say anwar, into the plural lights. No, light. Because there's only one light. And that's the light of guidance. Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, following in the footsteps of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And in fact, the footsteps of all of the Prophet's messengers that were sent from Adam, Jacob, Noah, Abraham, Enoch, Idris, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. All of them in that series until the end of them. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And Allah says, وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. And especially for the believers, Allah is incredibly merciful. And verse number 44, it's so beautiful how Allah, you know, brings it all together. تَحِيَّتُهُمْ يَوْمَ يَلْقَوْنَهُ سَلَامٌ وَأَعَدَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا كَرِيمًا. Their greeting on the day they will meet Him. The greeting on the day you and I will meet our Maker will be what? Salam. Peace. In Darus Salam, another name of paradise is the place of peace. وَأَعَدَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا كَرِيمًا. And for them, meaning the believers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared an amazing, an incredible, a generous reward. Don't we want to be from them? So coming back to these irreplaceable, amazing 10 days, my dear listeners, keep your tongue busy in the remembrance of Allah. When you're sitting down, when you're doing whatever, you're doing your grocery shopping or anything, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Keep your tongue busy. Constantly say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Walillahi alhamd. And we have Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu and Abu Huraira, as is reported to us in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, that they will go into the marketplace and they would say it out loud, reminding the people to engage in dhikr. Also, hadith reported in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad that the Prophet, peace be upon him, would fast the first 9 days of Dhul Hijjah. So if you can, keep an eye out, keep an ear out, when does Dhul Hijjah begin? And when you hear that Dhul Hijjah is starting, then insha'Allahu ta'ala, make the niyyah of fasting the first 9 days. If you cannot fast the first 9 days, then no problem. At least make it your intention to fast the ninth day, the day of Arafah, Yawmu Arafah. Try to fast the ninth day of Dhul Hijjah. Hadith in Sahih Muslim. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, whoever fasts the ninth of Dhul Hijjah, then the sins of the previous year and the sins of the upcoming year are forgiven. Oh my God. It doesn't even get better than this. 2 years worth of sins. And you're like, huh? My future sins? Allah is going to forgive. Yes. And the scholars explain these are the minor sins. The major sins, inshallah, you and I are not committing them. Zina, fornication, murder. These are all major crimes. Because if a person has committed a major crime, they have to turn to Allah in sincere repentance. And we've been talking about repentance and its importance, its significance, its power, its blessings in the last few khutbas. So go back and listen to them, inshallah ta'ala. So engage in dhikr. Try to fast the first 9 days. If you cannot, then at least the ninth day. Hadith found in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet, peace be upon him, said that if any one of you intends to sacrifice an animal, so this is the third good deed that we can do. So we've talked about dhikr adhkar. We've talked about repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've talked about fasting, right? And now the third good deed that we can do is sacrificing. It's an emphasized sunnah, if you can afford an animal, that you sacrifice an animal for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tells us in the Quran that it's not the animal's blood or its flesh that reaches Allah. What reaches Allah is the piety of our hearts. So many people are suffering in our neighborhoods, in our own backyards, in our own communities, who don't even get to eat meat the way you and I do on almost a daily basis. Distribute the meat to them. So if you intend to offer a sacrifice, then the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, it is good that you refrain from cutting your nails and the hair on your body. So groom yourself today or tomorrow, if Dhul Hijjah is starting on Sunday, and you won't take anything from them until the meat has been sacrificed or the animal has been sacrificed. Now, a question that arises is, what if my animal is being sacrificed overseas? When do I cut my nails? Very simple. When you go and celebrate your Eid, you've gone and offered your salah, your prayer, when you return, then you can groom yourself. Again, this is an emphasized sunnah. If for whatever reason you don't follow this, inshallah ta'ala, you're not sinful. The wisdom behind this particular thing, like, you will think, what's the point in me not trimming my nails or not cutting my hairs on my body? Well, the significance is that your entire body is in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're proving to God Almighty that, oh Allah, I don't really care about these little things. I'm focused on your worship, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Time is of the essence. There is so much more that I can share. But follow me on Instagram, on Facebook, on YouTube, where on a daily basis I'm posting content on the actions that we can do in Dhul Hijjah. And any questions that you have, feel free to drop them in the comment section. I read all of your comments. I'm putting out content in the Urdu language and the English language, and I have an open door policy. Just send me a direct message via in a Facebook Messenger or Instagram Messenger, and inshallah ta'ala, I'll make every effort to answer your questions. So in conclusion, think about the three things: your dhikr adhkar, your fasting, and then your sacrifice, inshallah ta'ala. Now, when you hear that the moon of Dhul Hijjah has been sighted, then you begin the unrestricted dhikr adhkar, meaning in whatever state that you are, you don't even need to be in a state of purity. You keep on saying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Walillahi alhamd, Subhanallah, Walhamdulillah, Wa la ilaha illallah, Wallahu Akbar. Keep on saying this right from the time you hear that Dhul Hijjah, the moon has been sighted, or Dhul Hijjah is starting, all the way until the 13th of Dhul Hijjah, Maghrib time. You continue doing these. These are called the unrestricted dhikr adhkar. Now, there are restricted dhikr adhkar, meaning those that are attached to certain forms of worship, and that is right after every obligatory prayer. After you've said the salam of each of the five daily prayers, you say astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. As we all know, the sunnah of the Messenger, peace be upon him, Allahumma anta salam, minka salam, tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. The regular dhikr adhkar the Prophet, peace be upon him, would do after each of the prayers. And then in a slightly loud voice, of course, you're not yelling or screaming, you say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, walillahi alhamd. Now, this dhikr that is restricted, meaning after each of the five prayers, this begins after Salatul Fajr on the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, meaning the day of Arafah. And you'll continue doing it until after the Asr prayer on the 13th of Dhul Hijjah, inshallah ta'ala. I hope, inshallah ta'ala, you benefited from this talk. If you did, consider, and I encourage you to share it far and wide, and you will get the reward just as you were the one presenting this, all of this information to the people. And what better way to rack up free of charge rewards than this? So easy to share it amongst all of your social media networks on Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, Telegram, TikTok, whatever it takes, inshallah ta'ala. And I pray to Allah that He grants you and me life to witness these first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, and He grants us tawfiq to make the most out of these amazing, incredible days. And I hope you'll follow me in each one of these episodes that I'm putting out in the Urdu language and in the English language on my social media handles. All of the details and timings of the broadcasts are mentioned in the description of this video. Don't forget to like and subscribe to my YouTube channel and follow me on Facebook and Instagram. Until next time, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.